Jim Powell was a jelly bean. I said a jelly bean, not a jelly bear. Much as I desire to make him an appealing character, I feel that it would be unscrupulous to deceive you on that point. He was a bread in the bone, dyed in the wool, 99.75% jelly bean, and he grew lazily all during jelly bean season, which is every season, down in the land of the jelly beans well below the Mason-Dixon line. Now, if you call a Memphis man a jelly bean, he will quite possibly pull a long, sinewy rope from his hip pocket and hang you to a convenient telegraph pole. If you call a New Orleans man a jelly bean, he will probably grin and ask you who is taking your girl to the Mardi Gras ball. The particular jelly bean patch which produced the protagonist of this history lies somewhere between the two, a little city of 40,000 that has dozed sleepily for 40,000 years in southern Georgia. Jim was a jelly bean. I write that again because it has such a pleasant sound. Jim was long and thin and bent at the waist from stooping over pool tables, and he was what might have been known in the indiscriminating North as a corner loafer. Jelly bean is the name throughout the undissolved Confederacy for one who spends his life conjugating the verb to idle in the first person singular. I am idling, I have idled, I will idle. Jim was born in a red brick house with a white fence on a green corner. His father died of a gun wound when he was 5. He grew up, went to school, wore his hair in black curls, and was afraid of girls. Sometimes the parents of little girls in town, remembering Jim's mother and fancying a resemblance in the dark eyes and hair, invited him to parties. But parties made him shy, and he much preferred sitting on a wall, rolling the bones, or exploring his mouth endlessly. For pocket money, he picked up odd jobs, and it was due to this that he stopped going to parties. At his 3rd party, Marjorie Height had whispered indiscreetly and within hearing distance that he was a boy who brought the groceries sometimes. So instead of dancing, Jim had learned to throw any number he desired on the dice and had listened to spicy tales of all the shootings that had occurred in the surrounding country during the past 50 years. He became 21. The economic crisis broke out and he needed money, so he enlisted as a do-all and polished mirrors and glasses in Charleston for a year. Then, by way of variety, he went north and polished mirrors and glasses in Brooklyn for a year. Back in the days when all the boys had detested all of the girls, Jim experienced being popular. But Jim's social aspirations had died in the thin air of Georgia. When he came back home, he was 23. Jim was still just a jelly bean, a weakling. He was without hope and without reason to go on. Jim's inadequacy with girls, due both to weak genetics and a hopeless lack of will, was just an aspect of his rooted cowardice and weakness, a fear of endeavoring any kind of activity or backing any kind of idea. As a matter of fact, we can certainly affirm that Jim was overall a loser. Cut. 3, 2, 1. Jim Powell was a jelly bean.